Do you want to learn how much an industry producer makes? This video is for you. So first, I want to disclaim this video by saying I've trained over 800,000 producers around the world. Some have gone to work with the top artists in the world, Kanye West, Drake, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, Young Thug, Polo G, French Montana. Did I say Post Malone? Yeah, I said Trippie Redd, Lil Baby, a lot of the top artists in the world. But that doesn't guarantee that you're going to work with them. Okay, everybody has a different experience. So I can't guarantee any success. I never have guaranteed any success the same way I wouldn't guarantee you any financial success from this. Like those guys have won diamond plaques, gold plaques, platinum plaques, but I can't guarantee that everybody will get the same results. Okay, so I want to start with that disclaimer because a lot of people put words in my mouth. But the question I have for you today is, how much do you truly think an average producer makes making placements? I want to hear in the comments below, how much do you think an industry producer makes in placements in the comments below? It's going to be a discussion because I really want to dig down to it. If I have to, I'll bring on people to verify this stuff. I've seen it in passing. I've seen it. Just because I'm not the one pursuing placements daily the way they are doesn't mean I don't get the information. Okay, so the first, I'm going to give you some idioms and some, or axioms might be the better word for it. To continue in life, these things you need to understand because these are the bullet point things to help you navigate better, even if you don't know all the details. Okay, so I want to start with this. I learned this from a lawyer, a law firm, like the first law firm I was working with. It's words in the air are not there. Okay, and I'll say this again. Words in the air are not there. In other words, just because people say it doesn't mean that they're going to do it. And legally speaking, too. So I want you guys to really remember this. Words in the air are not there. I don't care how many promises. I've been promised so many things from networks and different things. Like even on YouTube, there's a thing called a CN. I forgot what it's even called. Multi-channel network, MCN. And they promised I would work with Chief Keef and all these artists. But it was never on paper. So yeah, he could promise me all the world in sales, you know, over the phone and do all these things. But it on paper, it's not there. So it does not exist. There's no obligation to fulfill. So words in the air, not there. I just want to leave you with that because most of the creatives who get kind of screwed over in this industry are told stuff, but it's not written down. There's no action behind it. And I also want to give you a caveat to say, just because something's in a contract does not mean the contract will be enforced. So contracts don't mean that everything is just going to be, you know, protected. You know, that's why even if you guys study like hip hop and like the people like Jay Prince, for example, I think he mentions in one of his videos, he's like, just because he does business maybe by more handshake and conversations, but the difference is a Jay Prince, for example, can enforce his agreements, whereas a lot of people and a lot of companies can't enforce their agreements and won't enforce their agreements. They're just more so, think of a contract as more so a way to lay out what expectations are. Don't think of it as like a, you know, a life-changing thing, but also read your contracts yourself. Okay, so the third thing I would say is, your brand is what elevates your perceived value. So a lot of people are wondering, how does some producers get paid this amount? How do other producers who make the same beat get paid this amount? It's the same product, but they get paid more or less. And it's because your brand is what increases your perceived value. Why? It's because artists want to associate with people of status. The same way an artist that you love may wear Louis Vuitton or, you know, I'm trying to think of like the top brands, Coach or, you know, what's the other one? Gucci's or... you know, whatever the top brand is, they want to associate with those brands, Rolex, Rolls Royce, because those brands are established with luxury and are established with increased social value. So for example, somebody might work with Murder Beats because Murder Beats has a brand. He has an established social status. So you're not just buying a beat from Murder Beats, you're also buying his social status. And that's why people can charge a little bit more. One is for social status, and two is because they have an audience to actually distribute whatever they're creating. So for example, if I work with Murder Beats, who work with the Migos and all these top artists, I'm not only getting the beat from Murder Beats, I'm also getting his social status because he has a very good reputation, he's very good with like PR type stuff. And I'm also getting his audience. I don't know how many followers Murder Beats has, but I'm also getting my thing in front of all of his audience who most likely will like the song because he also produced for their other favorite artists, Migos, et cetera, et cetera. And that's why people do deals with people who are more established. It's not because they're better at the skill. It's because they have their business more intact. And that's what I teach, is how to create a business, a brand. And I'll get into my placements later down the line, but I want you guys to start thinking, how do you build your brand? Don't worry about the skill. Yeah, the skill is cool, but you can be the best chef in the world and work in the middle of nowhere. Nobody will ever know unless they travel to like you know, Iowa and go to your small restaurant to taste that real authentic cheesecake. Like, if it's not nationally known, nobody cares on a national level. So I want you guys to like expand and stop thinking that skill is the only thing that, you know, gets paid. There are tons of extremely brilliant people who don't get paid as much as extremely dumb people. Okay. So most business is not handled by the creatives. This is another myth I want to introduce to you, because if you don't understand this, then this will change the way you perceive things. But a lot of the creatives who give you advice and different things online or tell you about this or give you small little bits of information, they don't even handle their own business. They give their business to a lawyer or a manager or some other third party to take care of that for them. So they never negotiate. They never read contracts fully. They never, you know, like create terms and conditions. They never create the offer or the deal. It's somebody else. And they only know what they're told, which is fine. But just understand that a lot of the business stuff is not handled by the creative. The creative might make the decision to work with someone, but they don't actually handle the administrative stuff most of the time. Because a creative brain, I found, is very lazy, lackadaisical, is very disorganized. It's just meant to be chaotic because that's where we get ideas from. Whereas the analytical side, the technical side, that's why people come to BusyWorks Beats for a lot of stuff. It's because I'm both creative on the right side brain, I guess on your right is over here, creative, and then also technical and business-like. So people can respect me, because here's a thing, I'm going to add this point in, is that in music business, basically when people think they can lie to you or BS to you and get over with it, that's when you get finessed. Okay, so I know you've heard the term like knowledge is not power. It's actually the opposite. Knowledge knowledge is extreme power. It is extreme power, because when you know things, you can't be fooled. Wisdom is extreme power. So I want you guys to reprogram yourself to get knowledge and wisdom, because that's the thing that gives you the confidence to go into a room and know exactly what's going on. That's the thing that helps you be seen as an authority, is knowledge and wisdom. That's why I create these videos for you, to give you knowledge and wisdom so that you can go into these rooms more confident. You can go into these rooms with more leverage. Even if your brand isn't built, people know they can't finesse you. It's an attitude thing. It's a knowledge thing. Again, most people in music business get finessed because people can sense that they have some type of ignorance or they have some type of not knowingness, and they BS you. Okay. So here's another common myth. A&Rs are not the only point of contact. So I don't want you guys just chasing A&Rs, whatever that means. I've seen people on Clubhouse just put A&R in their bio just to try to be cool. Like, I want you guys to understand there's three main pockets to the music industry. There's what we call online producers, who are kind of cascaded and segmented from, we'll call it music industry producers, whatever that means. Okay. And then we'll say all the cool kids who try to be cool. Okay. So there's the people who just try to be cool in music. There's the industry people who work under labels. And then there's the online producer community for the most part. Those are your three buckets of people. The people who want to be cool are trying to be the A&Rs, like the cool kids throwing live events, but they're not really in the craft of music. They just want to look cool. They want the social status of music. Then there's people in the industry who are probably chasing financial motivations, but they do it for the love as well. But it's mostly financial, because they have to pay back the money that they're loaned by these labels. Sony, Warner, and Universal are the top of the pyramid there. They're basically employees. Most of them are employees. They don't have an entrepreneurial mindset. Then you have the online producers, who are your entrepreneurs, people who are doing it for themselves, independents, people on BeatStars, people making it happen, building businesses, building their own brand outside of needing Sony's help, Warner's help, and Universal's help. Okay, these are the people who are building from scratch. Okay, so A&Rs are not the only point of contact. I just want to really shatter that myth so that you're not chasing people who just want to be cool and have social status, because a lot of those people have a lot of fluff in their life. I'm not judging anyone. I've just seen it on Clubhouse. There's a very different side to the industry. Again, there's online, there's industry folks, and then there's these people who try to be cool by associating with the industry folks. And they're very fluffy, and there's not a lot of value there most of the time that I've seen. So I want you guys to understand too, and we're going to get into how much producers make, but I want to shatter all these myths, because if you don't understand these myths, you're going to operate in life thinking that certain things are true, and that's what's going to hold you back. Okay, so the next thing here is that managers and lawyers and publishers make lots of the plays in the industry. So again, instead of going to the actual A&R, whatever that means, or to the artist directly, sometimes the business is superseded by a manager, a lawyer, or a publisher. You guys have to remember, managers, I'm trying to make this so simple. Read the book by Michael Gerber called E-Myth. He talks about the layers of entrepreneurship. At the top of a pyramid, you have an entrepreneur. Underneath the entrepreneur, you have managers who oversee the entrepreneur's system. And then underneath the manager, you have workers, technicians, they're called in the book. But most people, when they go into the music industry, they want the manager to be their dad. Like, they want the manager to be their parent. They don't actually hire a manager. They want to work for a manager. So when a lot of people are like, I just need a manager and then I'll get on, they're thinking that the manager has all these magical opportunities and they're going to hand them down to the producer or the artist. And people put managers up on this like pedestal, which is fine if that's their business. But there's two sides to managing. You have people who manage with opportunities and they pass them down and they get a fee for that, passing on the deal flow. And then you have managers who work for you, who handle all the administrative technical stuff that you just don't want to handle or you're not organized enough to handle. So you need to really understand what a manager does and what it is. Same with lawyers or any other position. But most lawyers have management companies, okay? They have talent agencies or talent management companies to where they have a lot of people signed to them, aligned with them. And then what they do is they give deal flow to different people. So they'll give deal flow to, you know, producer they know over here because maybe the NHL needs some kind of music. They'll just pass it over to producer X because producer X is from this region or makes this type of music. And that's how they get a lot of opportunities. Again, a lot of the producers that you guys study from in the industry don't even create their own opportunities. That's why they can't tell you where opportunity comes from, because they don't have their own power base. They're relying on somebody else to give them something. And to me, that's a very pick me type of energy. I'm not judging anybody for picking that lane. It's a very dangerous place to be. It's very volatile. Imagine your whole career is based on if somebody else gives you an opportunity, if they're willing to give you an opportunity. We already know as Black men in America, it's hard enough to get opportunity from the bat. So imagine you have not only that aspect, but then you have to get the approval of all these people, some people who don't even have musical taste, you know, some people who are just not even into music at all, creating opportunities. And then they say, it's like, you have to have pick me energy at 100%. That's why a lot of producers fall into different scenarios and different problems. It's because you're trained to always try to people please. And that's the problem in this system is that, you know, when you come in with an employee mindset expecting entrepreneur outcomes, it's going to clash. Okay. So nextly, publishers create a lot of the plays as well. And publishers, think of it like a big email list. Okay. So Sony, Warner, and Universal, they need talent. Okay, they're not going to email every person individually one by one. That will take up way too much time. What they do is they have an email list or subsidiary companies with email lists, and they sign a bunch of people. Basically, all they do is do what we do. They just do it to industry people, whatever that means. Okay, so Sony will have an email list of, let's say, 100,000 producers and artists, and they need music for the next Marvel movie. They'll email everybody, all 100,000 people. Hey, guys, we need this. Whatever. Here are the descriptions for what we need. Whoever executes the best and whoever executes first gets the opportunity. It's the same exact thing with anything else online. Okay, so I don't want you guys thinking it's some magical unicorn that just magically gets all this stuff. It's the same exact thing as online business. Okay, but I want you to understand that sometimes publishers put you in those rooms and get you sessions. It's not always coming from a manager or a lawyer. Sometimes it's the actual people that are, you know, these producers are signed to, whether they have a pub deal or whatever their connection is, that's how they get into these rooms. They're not doing that based off of their own brand. They're doing that because they answered an email. Okay, so don't think that they're just creating this out the muscle. Okay, and here's another shocking kind of phrase you need to understand is there ain't no net. And I learned this from Dan Kennedy. He said it a different way. He said, there taint no net. There taint no net, or whatever he said. And what we mean is there's no net income. It's similar to Hollywood. Or actually, I learned that from Dan Kennedy and Dan Pena, funny enough, two Dans. So there ain't no net. And what I mean by that is in Hollywood, a lot of people see big numbers. They'll see, wow, this film made $53 million, but the film cost $52 million to produce. So it only net $1 million. And the way music works is the same way Hollywood works, is that the people who are prioritized get paid first. Producers and stuff get paid last. The further you are from the money faucet, the last you'll get paid, the further away you are from money, basically. So in this case, lawyers are closer to the money buckets. They're closer to the faucets, I should say. Labels are closer to the faucet. So let's make this like a movie analogy because you guys can understand movies. Remember, Sony makes movies, Warner makes movies, Universal makes movies. Okay, so this is all tied to a bigger system. And your music is just a component to the greater products that they're building. You guys got to remember, back in the 90s and all this, music was super popping because movies were super popping. Like, I learned about New Jack Swing because of the movie New Jack City. Like, if that movie never happened, I don't know if I would ever know about New Jack Swing as much as I do. And great, great, great things came out of movie soundtracks and movie associations to songs. So I don't want to get too deep down the rabbit hole. But my point here is that in Hollywood, again, a movie can gross 53, but the cost for the movie were $52 million. And for those who don't know, I've helped a lady behind the scenes with Mile High Studios. It's a $100 million film studio off of Vancouver, off of Vancouver Island on the left. I think it's on the left side of Canada. Okay, they have a major, major project. $100 million project they're raising for that project. And, you know, it's just a different thought process. I don't want to get down rabbit holes. Okay, so there ain't no net. So here's my point is in Hollywood, again, who gets paid first? Think of it. If you're making a movie, you raise however much from your executive producers or your funder, you know, your financiers. Okay. Why do they put money into a movie? Because they want their product shown as product placement. They want, you know, their location advertised. If you guys watch The Bachelor or The Bachelorette, they'll do very strategic product placement. They'll bring in hosts from other shows. They'll go to, you know, I think on the last Bachelorette, they had Virgin Cruise like the whole time. It was just Virgin Cruise. So they're advertising through a TV show. And Virgin probably paid, you know, ABC X amount of millions so that they would get on their cruise or whatever the deal was. And then they would advertise their cruise, pardon me, through The Bachelorette because they want to make it feel like a place of desire. They create desire through the content. Content creates desire. Okay, so let me get back to the whole ain't no net thing. So you got to think, if I'm producing a movie, think as if you're a film producer. Imagine you're a film producer. You're Steven Spielberg Jr. And it's your job to create the next Jaws. Okay, so what do you do first? You have to get financiers to make this happen. Okay, that's the first step is to get money in the door. Second step is you need to put the money to use. Okay, we need to block out this row in New York, or we need to hire this film studio that looks like a city, but it's really a built-in film studio, like estate, like a Tyler Perry's type of studios. Okay, we book that for a month. Okay, that's going to cost $1 million to book for a month. Okay, we need actors. Now we got to pay The Rock's fee. The Rock wants $20 million. We got to raise $20 million just for The Rock to be in the movie because, again, The Rock is a brand and he is also product. He's social status association. Okay, I don't want to get so deep with it, but he's basically living product placement. Okay, and so, okay, so we got to raise all this money for the stars. We got to buy the venue. We got to, you know, all the ancillary stuff about the operations of filming. You got to get the cameras, the equipment, the supplies. Okay, now we're up to a $30 million budget and we haven't even launched this thing yet. Now we need marketing. That's 20 more million. So that's 50 million right there. And then boom, the 50 million's gone before it even goes out to the public. Now we're hoping that the marketing works and then we reap back a lot of the money that went in. So now 53 million comes back and we spent 52 million. There's only 1 million left as far as net income. Okay, now that's usually what's negotiated because a lot of companies know that there isn't going to be net. So they'll negotiate on net income. Like for example, a lot of producers may agree to getting paid percentage of, you know, monies after the marketing budget or after they recoup whatever, you know, debt that they were in for the record. So that means you got to think how, I'm trying not to go on like 1,000 rabbit holes. I'm just trying to show you that if your deal is based on a net income thing, then chances are you're not going to get paid very much or at all for that specific thing. Because net income in the movie industry and the music industry don't really exist the way you think. Because think about, we're not going to go down this rabbit hole, but just think about how artists make their money right now. They make it with live shows. Okay, it's not the same as selling CDs anymore. And streaming is not the same exact thing as selling CDs. So a lot of these artists are going live. That's how they make their money at concerts and festivals. Let me make sure this audio is actually recording. That would suck if this just wasn't recording audio this entire time. Okay, so my point in saying all this is that the majority of the artist money comes from live, which means the streaming and the other part of the revenue still has to be recouped on whatever the deal was. Now, the net income of that could be this tiny because it could take forever for that thing to actually go into the net positive for that specific category. Okay, so you can get paid like 4%, but it's of this tiny, 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 tiny piece. So I don't want you thinking that as soon as you start producing, you're going to be the next bank. You know, the next, just, you know, you have 5% of everybody who's out in the field right now. That's not how it works. And funny enough, a lot of producers that you know dealt with these artists for free. Okay, so not even like an upfront fee. They didn't charge at all because they wanted to get ahead of the next person who charged, and they're willing to invest. Like a lot of people with, there's people with Drake placements, guys, who work with the top artists in the world who didn't get paid off of Drake placements. I just want that to like really set in. There are people who work with Drake who have not even gotten paid. And I'm not talking about because Drake's a bad person. I mean, because they chose to do it for free and they're aiming for that net income on the back end, or make, I don't know the everybody's deal, but I know people who for sure did not get paid a lot or at all for the best artists in the world. So I don't want you guys chasing these dreams that are sold by a lot of people in the industry. A lot of people in the industry want you to think that there's some kind of magical divide. Like, for example, I'm Busy Works Beats. You know me. We've trained over 800,000 producers around the world. Some have worked with French Montana, Young Thug, Polo G, Lil Baby, Trippie Redd, Drake, Kanye, J. Cole. I missed J. Cole earlier. Did I say Post Malone? Ariana Grande. I'm starting to repeat myself. And a lot of the top artists in the world who have worked on Billboard, they've gone diamond, platinum plaque, and gold plaque. But that doesn't mean you're going to get the same results. It just means they applied all the knowledge that I'm teaching them and they had the ability to really lock in and take that risk. So I can't guarantee everybody those successful results. Those are just a few unicorns. And my point in saying this is that you really need to know, I was going to add in something and I forgot. I was going to add in a point and I completely forgot what I was talking about. It's all good. We'll move to the next point. Producers become DJs to gain live show income. So remember, a lot of the money in music now is from live shows. So why do Murder Beats and Metro become DJs? It's because they want to access that live show income stream, whereas most producers don't have access to that live show revenue. What was I talking about? Man, it's going to bother me until I remember. But I was just saying how Drake placements don't necessarily mean you're getting paid a lot. And I was going to go somewhere with that, but I lost the thought. So there's a big debate about internet versus industry producers. Oh, here's what I was going to say. Busy Works Beats, for example, trained all these people around the world, worked with the top audio companies in the world. Let me just give you guys credentials. It's a little late in the video, but I'm going to give you some credentials. This is a marketing thing. You got to give your credentials so people listen to you. I probably should have done this earlier, but whatever. I didn't want to sound like I was flexing. So Busy Works Beats, we've trained over 800,000 producers around the world. Some are going to work with Kanye West, Drake, Post Malone, Ariana Grande, Polo G, Lil Baby, J. Cole, Trippie Redd. I'm not promising you those results. I'm just saying some of the people are extremely successful with the stuff that we've trained them with. Okay, going diamond even, which is very hard to do. And we work with the top audio companies in the world. Universal Audio, Arturia, Sweetwater. Universal Audio, I don't know how much they make, but I know Sweetwater was like $600 million revenue. We work with Razer, the laptop company, longer than Sony Digital and longer than Murder Beats and longer than Metro Boomin. No shade. I'm just saying, like, you know, people have to reshape placements, and I'll get into that in a second. But, you know, Razer, which is, they were valued at $5 billion. I think they're a billion something valuation at right now. Company. Then you have, we work with Waves, Arturia, Image Line, Isotope. Basically all the top audio companies in the world we work with. So, and also I've worked in Web3 with, I'm trying to think of all the net values of all these companies, forgive me here, with the Near Protocol. I think they're valued at like, they were valued at like 5 billion, I think, or 7 billion. I forget, it's been so long since 4 billion. I have to look at their value now. But they're a tech company in the billions, funded by A16Z and all these high level investors. And my point is, I've worked with the top brands in the world, billion-dollar brands, and not only $1 billion brand, multiple billion-dollar brands. I've done that based on my own experience and my own merit and doing this alone and independent. Thank God, of course. I don't want to make it sound arrogant. I'm saying, and you need also to look up the definition of arrogance. Arrogance means to overly estimate somebody's value. It means saying that I can do things that I can't. I'm just telling you what I've done. I'm not trying to make it seem overly exaggerated. Which a lot of producers do when they're trying to sell you a dream. So I'm just telling you what I've done in the past, because imagine, okay, Busy Works Beats, who's done all this stuff, worked with the top brands in the world. Okay, now I get signed to Sony, that magically makes me some kind of magical thing just because I signed to Warner, Universal, or Sony. Now I'm validated. No, I was validated a long time ago when Rodney Jerkin shouted me out for my cord codes a long, 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 long time ago. That was back in 2016, I want to say. Yeah, or 15. Thank you, Rodney Jerkins, for that. You know, and I was validated along the way by all these top producers, by all these, you know, by you, really, building an audience, a real audience. So I'm not seeking to be validated by getting the stamp of some company. I've already worked with the top companies in the world. I don't need to be validated at this point for myself and for other people. It doesn't equal the same amount of social proof just to be signed by somebody. Okay, so just because somebody signed does not make them like this magical thing. So I don't know why industry producers do it. My only guess is that I think they want to separate from the online producers because they have to justify their price. If me and you sell the same exact thing, I have to give the customer a reason why you should pay me more. And the most BS reason they give customers or artists a reason why they should pay more is because they're in the industry. They're signed to Sony or Warner, Universal, or any of the subsidiaries, and they're in the industry. So that makes them more valuable just because they're signed. But you got to remember, what makes people more valuable is the brand. You can build brand without being signed. Let me say that again. You can build your brand without being signed. Okay, signing does not, there's a lot of ways to increase your social status. So I don't want you thinking that you have to give away your whole life just to get more placements or charge more. Okay, so to me, placements are just social proof. My whole career is based on my audience. Thank you for being a valid, valuable part of my life. I serve you guys. You're my audience. I'm serving you. That's it. Now, placements are social proof. A lot of people try to build their credentials and their whole like life system around their placements. And we're going to get into it as to why I don't do this is because here's my question that I ask the people who focus on placements so much. Is what is a Drake placement to Drake? So most people want to work with Drake. They're like, I can't wait to get my Drake placement. Okay, but if I'm Drake himself, what is a Drake placement to Drake? Who's the Drake of Drake's life? It may be some higher artist like Beyonce or Jay-Z or whatever. Okay, then we can go up the chain and say, okay, the best musician and artist in the world, let's say Kanye West, Jay-Z, whoever the top of the top is for them. Okay, I'm Jay-Z, Kanye West. What's a Kanye West or Jay-Z placement to Jay-Z and Kanye West? It doesn't mean the same thing. So when you are the person, it doesn't mean the same thing. And what I'm saying is that Kanye West works with Gap, works with Adidas, works with Nike, works with Louis Vuitton. Drake works with Sprite, works with, I think, was it Adidas? I'm mixing it up. Or Nike, one of them. Forgive me for not remembering there. But my point is these big artists are going to the brands to get deals and different things. I asked the question, why do I need a middleman called an artist to get to the brands? I'm just going to go to the brands directly. I don't need the middleman to help me get there or to validate me or to increase my odds of getting there. It's cool to do that as leverage, but that's not the only way to get there. So I have a different perspective about the industry and placements to where I don't chase other artists to potentially, hopefully get to the brand, to the brands. I will call the brand up directly or figure out how to work with the brands directly. I don't need an artist. And that's the way I approach the industry. Not everybody does it that way, but that's why people come to me for very strategic thinking and how do they get around these obstacles. It's because I don't work in this pyramid called the music industry. I don't work in their system that's designed to keep producers and artists at the bottom of the pyramid. And I can go deep into that pyramid scheme, basically, but I just don't have enough time. If I remember, I'll link the video below. Somebody helped me find that video I did about the producer music industry where I did the whole pyramid thing. I forgot what video it is. I made so many videos, but okay, so let's get to it. Placements are really just social proof, okay? I don't want you guys thinking placements are money opportunities all the time. It's not always a money opportunity all the time. And just because you're not in the industry doesn't mean you're not in the industry. If you look up these definitions for music producer, music industry, the short of it is basically if you create music and it goes somewhere and it goes into a marketplace of the greater music community, you're in the music industry. You don't have to be signed to anybody to be in the music industry. You don't have to be in LA. You don't have to be in New York, Miami. You don't have to be in ATL to be in the industry. It's just a pseudo term created to create this imaginary divide between people who are, you know, they have to justify their price. So they're like, I'm an industry guy or girl, whatever it is. Okay. So it's all BS marketing stuff. Now, lastly, here's a phrase I hear a lot. If you don't sell beats, you don't know selling. In other words, people say, you haven't sold beats, so you don't know what it's like, or you don't know how to do it. tell Grant Cardone he doesn't know how to sell a car, or tell Grant Cardone he doesn't know how to sell a vase, or tell Grant Cardone he doesn't know how to sell, you know, a getaway on an island. Just because he didn't offer the product does not mean he doesn't know how to sell. Once I learned that selling can be applied to all industry, it's just a matter of what's your expertise in that industry. If I can sell coal, I just have to learn about coal. I have to learn how it works, who's the buyer, you know, who the buyers are. I have to learn about coal. I have to learn about the processes, why this coal is better than that coal, or this industry energy source. That's, once you learn selling, it's a skill set, but then you have to get the knowledge of the market. So just because somebody doesn't sell beats doesn't mean they don't know how to sell. That's almost idiotic and super dumb to say. So I want you to really get that out of your head, because if you hold that in your head, you're never going to get far in selling. Okay, because I've been in jewelry. I've been in online sales. I've been in health. And in my jewelry thing, I sold other people's jewelry online, as a matter of fact, as an affiliate. I didn't know what I was doing. I was just writing a blog and I had this whole thing going. I sold hip hop jewelry. That's my history in there. In health, we had the pre-med club that I started in my sophomore year. We wanted to start a fraternity, but it was blocked at Villanova University because apparently the TKE had some kind of history of cocaine or something at the fraternity. So we couldn't start that frat. So we had the energy to build something. So we just moved it into building our own pre-med club, which went to win the best club award, fastest growing club award. We went from 100 members to 200 members with no marketing. It was insane. So that's where I learned a lot about life. Had doctors flying in for nothing. You know, like I learned so much. I created opportunities and internships for people for free. Like this was all just picking up the phone and calling people. I've been in the film industry helping out and mentoring film folks to understand how to negotiate better terms as actors, or if they're in film as a, videographer, you know, getting better opportunities and different things. Fashion. You know, somebody creating a whole fashion line from scratch. Literally, I remember them telling me the idea to them executing. It was pretty amazing. Software, I've been selling software. You guys already heard it. Our evolution from Vintage Fire to Hermes Synth, to TBD, to now we're working on something called Narcos. So I've been in software. I've been in sound development. I've been in training. You guys already know about our courses, which you can go to premium.busyworksbeats.com to get some free courses if you want to understand like the deeper side of BusyWorks Beats. I don't put everything on YouTube. It's just not enough time, really. And then it's also focused on the website. Whereas YouTube, you have to be very like trendy. And then lastly, I've been in the event space. So I've created myself, you know, events and different things. So when you see all these different industries, my point is you'll start to see the commonalities in these industries. And selling is selling is selling. Business is business is business. It comes down to three simple steps: traffic, value creation or value exchange, and the follow-up process or the relationship process. Okay, so that's something you really need to get out of your head. Okay, so getting to what producers actually make in the music industry, it's about $1,000 per placement. Now, everybody ranges. Some people claim they make $4,000. Some people claim they make $10,000. It's like a rapper saying on his record, you know, pay me $100,000 for the feature. Really, $100,000 for the feature? You know, Lil, I can't even think of it. There's probably a Lil. If I say Lil anything, it's probably somebody else actually out there named Lil. But you guys got to realize that when people project stuff out, like if they say I get paid this amount or pay me this amount, they're trying to increase their value most of the time. Okay. So if I say, you know, I got paid this amount on a record 17,000 years ago, this is what you're trying to anchor into the customer's mind to think that is your value. Okay. So when you hear artists saying they get paid $100,000 for a feature, or producers saying they want $5,000 or whatever it is, it's probably because they only got paid one. Okay. In reality. And anybody claiming they make so much off of a placement, show the receipts. Any money-related stuff, I've never made claims to money-related stuff, guarantees. Like I said, guys, we train over 800,000 producers around the world. Some have gone diamond. Some work with the top artists in the world, Drake, Kanye West, J. Cole. I think Kendrick's in there. There's so many artists that I don't remember. I would have to really gather a whole list. But literally the top artists in the world and on the Billboard, diamond, platinum, gold, plaque, winning producers, that doesn't guarantee that you watching this are going to do the same thing, because they may have a different drive. They may have a different, you know, a different why. You know, they may be suffering for 10 years and then get one placement, whereas you want to live a comfortable life or a more sustainable life and maybe get one less placement than them. So I just want you guys to just understand this. Okay, it's about $1,000. So let's make some realistic math. So to make $20,000 a month, you would have to have 20 placements a month. Now, how many producers do you hear getting 20 placements a month? Consistently 20 placements a month. So 20 placements a month would make you $20,000 a month, pardon me. And then 20,000 times 12 is around 200K. We'll just say 200K plus, which sounds great. It is great to have that much income. But again, the problem with this system is that it's not consistent and most producers do not control the deal flow. In other words, their career is based on somebody else approving something. Can you imagine your whole life is based on if somebody approves something or not? That would be a miserable life. That's like living under your parents 24/7. Like, I can't eat candy because my parents said no. You just never know when your parents are going to say yes or no. Okay, so let's get into some realistic math. Okay, so let's say you get about $1,000 per placement with options of points on the back. Some people don't even get, they get half a point, so it doesn't even really matter. 20,000 a month, let's say you get, but it takes 20 placements to get there consistently. So you need 20 placements every month, which is insane. Okay. And I'm going to show you how industry producers really operate. Okay. And that would give you about 200,000 a year. Now that's extremely ideal. Now 200K a year is still under par from what some people on BeatStars have done. And I'm saying BeatStars because there's a lot of hate towards BeatStars because people don't know, they don't understand online business. The rationale for most producers is not that we're trying to chase artists. People have different motivations. Some people want to be cool, which is the majority of people. They just want to be cool. They need validation of other people, so they need to work with the top artists to be validated. There's other people who just want wealth and money. They want their family to be well off and have resources. Those people who want money and wealth, you probably have heard this where people are like, I'd rather be rich and unknown than famous and rich, or whatever like the contrast was. And that's because they don't care about being cool. They care about the money aspect and the resource aspect. So depending on which approach you take to music can determine which path you take. If you're very cool motivated, you want to be cool, you want to be seen, you want to be social, and that's all you care about, and build friendships and all this, then maybe the placement route is for you because there's a lot of hanging around in studios and wasting time and partying and doing all this kind of stuff. It's cool, but it's just, it doesn't necessarily get you money. And also, you know, it depends on your personality type. Whereas BeatStars, you may not get the party lifestyle or get the sleeping on the couch of the studio for 2 days, you know, bumming it with your friends. But on BeatStars, you might figure out a business model where you can earn, let's say, $10,000 a month on the higher end. Okay, $10,000 a month. And this is all, it's not passive. Nothing in business is truly passive. I don't preach passive anything. So let's say $10,000 a month, you got the ads going, you got the whole system going. It's pretty basic, you know, three-step business. Okay. And then you do that for what, 12 months? So that's 120 a year. And again, this is on the high end, but 120 a year, but you're not sacrificing your body. You're not sacrificing time. You're not worried about like the pick me energy. You're not trying to appease a record label or appease somebody, or you're actually getting paid on time because PayPal pays on time. You can even dispute payments that get chargebacks and all this type of stuff. Whereas the industry, sometimes people don't even get paid for a record. They'll agree to pay somebody $1,000, but they might not get paid the $1,000. They may pass over the track and then never get paid. So with online stuff, there's a lot more accountability and it's just a trade-off. So there's no greater or worse. I just want you guys to understand that when it comes to industry producers, you guys need to realize a lot of them are making less than you are if you have an online business. A lot of them have worse brands than you. Because you have an online business, you're seen, and they don't have the same exact online branding that you have. They don't understand online, so they demonize it. People who don't understand stuff demonize it. And I just want to give you hope to know that you can build a lot of this stuff online without giving away any equity or percentage of your company and without being signed to anybody. And I want you guys to walk away understanding that the industry does not make you this magical unicorn just because you're signed to somebody or have worked with X and Y artists, because a lot of the people who have worked with these people are getting paid a lot less or a lot less frequently than online producers. So it depends on what you want. I chose the, I want to work with brand side. I want power. I want to feel powerful. I want to feel like I'm building something like an empire. So I want to work with brands directly. I want to create deal flow. These are my motivations. I want to create deal flow. I want to have cash flow business, meaning because a lot of people treat industry stuff like real estate. The way I approach real estate, for example, if I were in real estate more deeply, I would think apartment complexes or commercial real estate where I know there's income coming in. Most people, when they get into real estate, they buy it and hold it and just pray that the value goes up. Okay, like they'll buy a single family home for $100,000 and just hope that in 5 years it values up to $200,000. But the problem with that business model is there's no income. So you're just waiting for 5 years at a loss, hoping that it will go up in value. Whereas I approach business where it's like, if I'm going to buy a single family home, I'm going to have renters in there, or we're going to split it. Or, you know, I wouldn't even go for single family. I would go for apartment type stuff because there are tenants there who are paying monthly, paying consistently. It's called cash flow. I focus on the cash flow, not just the value of something. But that's my approach to business in general, because I feel like cash flow is the actual value generation for the economy. There's a lot of derivatives and a lot of paper stuff that I just don't feel is real. It's truly based on psychology and what people believe, which is very volatile. So anyway, brands, I deal with brands. I create deal flow for myself and for others. Cash flow. These are the things I create. Content, marketing, like these are the things I focus on. And to be an online presence, you have to create a lot of this stuff. So I can get deep in, like if you guys want me to go deeper on these concepts, let me know in the comments below. This video is probably 30 minutes long. Let's see. The video is 41 minutes long. Holy crap. But hopefully you guys understand that there's no magical divide between industry and internet producers. Internet producers probably make more than the industry producers. And understand that a lot of industry producers come to me for advice on how to do this internet thing. They have accomplished a lot of things in the industry, but they're still coming to me. I'm not bragging. I'm saying this because we all have to be humble to understand that in the industry, most people don't have any power. And that's because they're handed opportunity. They never created it for themselves, or they're under the authority of someone else and they never have the authority for themselves. I want you guys to feel what it feels like to have the full authority to run your own enterprises, to where you make the decisions and then other people follow your decisions. Now, if you want more like specific music industry, like how to, or like the step-by-step stuff, just go to our Discord. It's busyworksbeats.com/Discord. We have this to-do list for songwriters and producers right here. It's a list that you can follow with all the like stuff you need to sign up for. So I'll leave that link below. Thank you for watching. It's Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. Peace.